Euromaxx Highlights, and here's your host, Anne O'Donnell.
Hello and welcome to Euromaxx Highlights, where we select the top reports of the week for you. Here's a look at our top three. In the spotlight, Berlin's Festival of Lights attracts more than 2 million spectators. Dancing drones using quadrocopters for stage performances. And photo app, amateur photographers are making a splash with Instagram. Well, as you can see behind me, the annual Festival of Lights is still underway here in Berlin. It's celebrating its 10th anniversary, and every year you get to see the German capital in a completely different light. Well, many of the famous sites and monuments like the Brandenburg Gate have become a backdrop for spectacular light and video projections. This year, up to 120 buildings have been illuminated all over the city.
These three men designed the images that now illuminate the Brandenburg Gate by night. Wolfram Lenson created the concept, Hannes Neumann the 3D graphics, and Daniel Kornachak did the sound. The trio is using their light show to tell stories about Berlin. For instance, how much the city has changed.
It's a very thrilling moment to see the things you've come up with in private projected onto the Brandenburg Gate for the first time. To see what the gate makes of it, as the gate itself interprets my ideas.
On the night before the Festival of Lights began, Lenson made the final adjustments to the images. Although he decided on the concept 6 months ago, he was still working round the clock as the opening day drew near.
There's still a lot of fine-tuning to do. There's still a lot of color balancing that needs doing. The whole project must be reviewed and checked to see if everything really fits. The work never stops. That's what's so exciting about it.
Hannes Neumann uses special software for his light art. Like a sculptor, he uses it to model objects and define their movements. Adapting these objects to match the landmark takes real skill.
You start with a model of the Brandenburg Gate like this, then using the 3D program, you capture a shot from the perspective of where the projectors stand. And that creates an effect that looks as if the building is putting on an outfit.
The Brandenburg Gate has been dressed in 8 such outfits, including one involving animated architecture and one inspired by Berlin's club scene.
I wanted to use art forms to turn the spotlight on the Brandenburg Gate, but I also wanted to generate different emotions with every scene.
Wolfram Lenson is one of many artists invited to take part in this year's Festival of Lights. At Berlin's cathedral, international light designers have visualized their idea of joie de vivre. The artistic collective Grotesque Maru shows its interpretation of light and movement at Potsdamer Platz. Light projections can also be seen at Babelplatz, for instance, at the Hotel de Rome. All of the illuminations on public display are free of charge. Many people flock to see the Festival of Lights year after year. 2 million came last year.
The festival is wonderful. This light show makes Berlin look even nicer.
The actual light images that we saw were really nice.
Everyone's taking photos. It's a peaceful festival without music. It simply captures culture in images.
It's fun to walk through Berlin and rediscover the city, to see all of the exciting images and lights. It's fascinating.
The Festival of Lights has been fascinating people for a decade now. Its team of organizers has presented more than 1,000 light installations and has received international recognition.
My dream has come true. At the start, I wondered how things would be in 10 years' time, but it just keeps on developing. Now we're going big internationally. In November, we have our first sister festival in New York, which we're really looking forward to.
And there are plans to bring the festival to Canada, Malaysia, and several European countries. Back at the Brandenburg Gate, the light show lasts for 5 hours until midnight, and that'll continue in the coming days. Light artist Wolfram Lenssen will also be among the spectators.
My work is never done. It's over at the end of the Festival of Lights, but then I'm already thinking about what I could do better next time.
Was kann man besser machen?
The lights will go out at the festival on October 19th. But until then, Berlin will continue to outshine itself.
Well, over to the British capital now for a relationship that might be described as complicated. The British Museum has put on a major exhibition that looks at 600 years of German history, from the Renaissance to reunification and beyond. Sometimes enemies, sometimes allies, sometimes rivals. We wondered what the British really think of the Germans today. So Euromaxx's roving reporter Hendrik Velling made his way to London to find out.
Euromaxx reporter Hendrik Velling wants to know what's the image of Germans in Britain.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm German. I'm from Germany.
Instead of being pelted with rotten eggs, his initiative is met with laughter. But whether they're laughing with him or at him isn't clear.
I think we're more similar to the Germans, say, than the French or the Italians or the Spanish. We have a lot of common history. Not all of it bad. Some of the stereotypes are quite deep-seated, but there's a lot more to it.
What has just happened? What's up with the British? Don't they hate us anymore? And now, in addition, there's this exhibition on display in the legendary British Museum, which I'm going to check out right now.
The British Museum is one of the world's top museums and welcomes some 6 million visitors each year. Its new exhibition called Germany, Memories of a Nation shows everything from a Volkswagen Beetle to Meissen porcelain to pictures of Goethe, objects covering 600 years of German history.
I have German friends, so kind of all the clichés that I did have about Germany have kind of been wiped away by them. So, no, I think it'll be interesting because I think they're trying to kind of delve under the clichés and see what Germany's really about, maybe.
It's not that the Germans don't have a sense of humour, it's that the British don't have any funny jokes.
As a German, you do go in wondering, what are the Brits saying about us? But I was surprised, in a good way.
But surely our reporter can manage to offend someone. He heads for the offices of The Sun, a tabloid not exactly known for mincing its words about the Germans. But even here, there's no trace of animosity.
I just realized that the German-British relationship has somehow changed.
It's warming up.
Yes.
Do you think? No, I think we've talked about this quite a lot here, that there's a sense, I think, in Britain of kind of respect and admiration for Germany, which going back historically, there probably wasn't, and there obviously there's been moments in recent years where the relationship's probably been a bit tense. But actually, I think what you're seeing now is a recognition of lots of stuff that Germany does well, and dare I say it, stuff that we wish we would do as well as Germany.
Even when it comes to soccer, where the two countries have long been arch enemies, headlines like this have become rare.
Football goes a long way in this country. There's a sense that you've got good cars, you do some sort of social policies that we admire a bit, you've got a leader that the world looks up to. All in all, we probably have a bit of a grudging respect for Germany, and that comes out in a bit of admiration and a bit of gentle mockery as well.
What happens when relations are given the stress test?
Three hugs from a real German.
Is the Brit on the street ready to take a hug from a German? Apparently so.
I'm a little bit surprised how well it went with giving away free hugs, and I'm not quite sure if it's because I'm German or if it's just because of the free hugs, but it was wonderful.
The last stop is another great British institution, the pub. But this one is serving German beer. Owner Jürgen Mennel is German, but he's learned to adapt.
Humour in England is more highly developed than in Germany. Criticism is always meant in fun. If you don't get all offended and just give back as good as you get, it works. After the second beer at the very latest.
A good draft import and the old rivalries go down the tubes. What's left is the love.
It's been a fantastic atmosphere. It's there's no animosity. The German issue, it's fantastic. German people are great.
Ich liebe Deutschland.
Ich liebe Deutschland.
Ich liebe Deutschland.
They're the best of friends. Well, now, flying lampshades. It's the stuff of dreams, or of theatre. A university in Zurich has come up with an ingenious and practical way to liven up theatre backdrops and enhance performance art using flying drones dressed up as lampshades. One company who uses their work is the renowned Canadian theatrical company, Cirque du Soleil. Well, let's have a look at how the Swiss Research Institute are revamping performances and theatre with their creations.
It's like a scene from Disney's Fantasia. Lampshades dancing through the air as if they've come to life. You might think this is a computer animation, but the shades are real, and they're really flying thanks to hidden quadcopters. The drones were programmed at the ETH University in Zurich. Roboticists here created a computer algorithm which they believe will set new standards in show business.
There is no way that human beings could control these lampshades, with a remote control and do what we did in that film. You can only do that through this coordinated, autonomous infrastructure that we've developed. To have them flying in these formations, the way that they interact with the performer. This is really breaking new ground.
Each of these flying lampshades is propelled by a tiny quadcopter. The scientists worked with Canadian entertainment firm Cirque du Soleil on the choreography and pre-programmed most of the movements. Part of the concept was to keep the quadcopters from being seen.
At first, we thought it was really interesting to put lights on the quadcopters. And then at some point, almost by accident, some of our colleagues just, joking and talking about a lampshade. And that made me stop in my tracks. And I thought, wait a minute, did you say lampshade? Well, that could be really interesting. What if we had a number of lampshades starting to fly?
They choreographed and filmed the video in a special rehearsal room. The programming of the drones took 2 weeks. While many of their movements are determined in advance, the algorithm permits autonomous behavior, for instance, allowing the drones to move to prevent a collision. Using infrared cameras, a computer tracks the positions of the drones, which are connected with one another via Wi-Fi. This researcher monitors the activity. This performance is also the result of their quadcopter research. At the Lions Festival of Creativity in Cannes, France, an ad agency showed what the theater of the future could look like. 16 flying mirrors reflect the glow of the spotlights.
Basically, you want to be able to have access in three dimensions to space. And this allows you to do that. You can have things moving around the stage in an arbitrary way without string. So then, for folks that design sets, a lot of things come to mind. Geez, if I could do that, So, for shows, to have the ability to have, the equivalent of birds, of flying objects, can be brought into can give a certain meaning in a theatrical setting that you wouldn't be able to do otherwise.
What scientists are aiming for is to make tomorrow's entertainment today. They believe quadricopters will soon be playing a role in big shows and concerts. But even small venues will likely come up with bright ideas for the flying robots from Zurich.
Well, the fact that most mobile phones have inbuilt cameras these days means it is now possible for just about anyone to become a photographer. But not everyone will have their images shown in art galleries or featured in design magazines. Euromaxx met three clever young men whose unique take on architecture has garnered them worldwide attention and turned them from being amateurs into true pros.
These perfectly composed architectural images are not the work of professionals. They were taken by amateurs on their smartphones and have been edited using an app. One of the photographers is Sebastian Weiss. A designer by profession, he started dabbling in photography about 15 years ago. In 2010, he downloaded the photo-sharing app Instagram and started posting his pics. He's now known internationally for his work.
When I started out 4 years ago, I never thought I would reach this stage. I was really just experimenting, seeing what I could do. But it really pleases me to see that people like my work and to read their feedback. It's just a brilliant feeling.
Sometimes Sebastian just stumbles upon the buildings he shoots. On other days, he knows exactly where he wants to train his lens. Today, he's focusing on the St. Canisius Church in Berlin's Charlottenburg district. Given the restrictive size of the smartphone format, he stays clear of overly ornate buildings. But that's not the only criterion that influences his choice of motif.
The buildings that particularly appeal to me have different surface structures and materials. This church is a good example of the equal use of the kinds of materials. You have both wood and concrete. It doesn't matter to me if something was designed by a famous architect. I just need to feel a sense of fascination.
Characteristic for Instagram is the square Polaroid image format. And it has to be perfectly framed because Sebastian does very little retouching work. But he does sometimes use a special app that corrects lines. To finish off, he puts his images through Instagram's Brannon color filter and then uploads them to his feed.
I developed this way of working fairly early on, and it's a kind of branding on my feed. I think a consistent feed where attention to detail is evident stands a greater chance of prolonged success.
Sebastian studied design at the Berlin University of the Arts. He can be found on Instagram under the name Leblanc, where he has some 117,000 followers. In his photo feed, he takes great care to ensure a mix of symmetrical images, organic forms, and geometric objects. Another successful Instagram photographer is Dirk Bakker, whose work appears under his alias Mackenzo. The Dutch graphic designer has more than 230,000 followers, and 2 years ago he teamed up with four other Instagram users to set up a company dedicated to mobile photography. The images of Spaniard Emilio Oti, a professional physicist known as Otia, are regularly featured in magazines. The architecture network Archilovers rates him among the top 15 architecture photographers on Instagram.
People always have a need to express themselves in one way or another, and Instagram gives them the chance to do that in images, in terms of what they see.
Sebastian also enjoys photographic success beyond the bounds of Instagram. He works as a photo columnist for the high-profile magazine Architectural Digest Germany, and his work is represented by a gallery in Los Angeles.
Instagram has changed my life. I never expected to be getting requests from different magazines, or to have professional architecture photographers asking me for tips, or to have architecture students asking if they can intern with me. It's really incredible, and it makes me happy.
At the end of last year, Sebastian Weiss began to exhibit his Instagram images in the real world as well as in the virtual one. And in the coming years, he plans to build on his current success.
Well, if you're planning a trip to my home country, Ireland, then this next report will be of interest to you. Of course, there are lots of great spots to see there, but Euromaxx decided to head to the famous Ring of Kerry in the southwest of Ireland. There are lots of friendly people there to meet, but it seems that one very famous and mischievous pet dolphin is the star attraction that draws in the crowds to one of the more popular travel regions in Ireland.
The sea. The cliffs, the hills, the rugged beauty of Ireland's Atlantic Ocean coast. Each year, 1.5 million tourists from around the world flock here to the Dingo Peninsula. They explore the landscape along the wild Atlantic Way. The main town and tourist center is Dingle, a fishing port with about 1,200 inhabitants. But Dingle's most famous resident doesn't live in the town. He resides offshore. Fungi. The Dingle Dolphin. 30 years ago, this bottlenose dolphin began frequenting Dingle's harbor area. Jimmy Flannery takes tourists out in his boat every day to see him. And on this day too, Fungi doesn't disappoint his fans. He likes to be around people.
Come on. Come on, hello!
Oh, you're gorgeous!
Come on!
No one knows why Fungi has made Dingle Bay his home. People here don't feed him.
The only reason Fungi stays here is because he wants to. And I get asked that question over and over and over again, you know. But it is. It's obviously there's enough fish there for him. There's no natural predator, and he enjoys it. So there's no other reason.
Dolphin watching aside, the scenery is the most enticing thing about this part of County Kerry. And it's best explored on bicycle or on foot. Nestled in the rolling hills are centuries-old buildings like Kilmall Kedder Church in the northern part of the Dingle Peninsula. Now a historic monument, this Romanesque church once boasted a stone roof. Just a few kilometers away is Dingle's most famous landmark, the Galerus Oratory. Made of stone, it's believed to be an early Christian church built in the 8th century. Its shape is reminiscent of an overturned boat. Back in Dingle, there are more culinary treats in store, like the Global Village, a fish restaurant operated by Martin Balin. The chef has traveled to more than 40 countries, and he's returned home with new ideas. He serves international cuisine made with local ingredients, like scallops with poached egg on cucumber.
Up to 15 years ago, we didn't have a great reputation for food. Chefs have traveled abroad, they've gained experience internationally, and they've returned to Ireland, and we have found that there's a bounty on our doorstep of the most amazing ingredients from the Atlantic seaboard, beautiful fish and shellfish, incredible dairy, incredible meats and vegetables. So we've brought imagination to the table. So the days of the pub food and the days of the not so great food are over in Ireland now. And in any town you go to, right up along the Wild Atlantic Way, you can eat really, really well.
And Ireland is famous for its pubs. There are around 50 in Dingle alone, including some unique ones like Foxy John's Bar. Half hardware store, half vintage pub, it's the place to get some nails with your Guinness. With or without hardware, traditional Irish folk music is played in many pubs. John Benny's pub offers musical entertainment every night. Often it's provided by the owner's wife, Eilish Kennedy, half of the duo called Lumiere.
Well, if it was just a tourist attraction, we wouldn't be doing it. It's part of what we grew up with. It definitely is something that is a big bonus for people to find here. I mean, the scenery is beautiful, the food is beautiful, the drink is great, but just music is something that sets a place apart, and I think that sets this area apart a lot.
Later on, her husband John, the bar's owner, joins her on stage. Together, they sing traditional Irish songs about Dingle and County Kerry.
That's all we have time for at the moment. Thank you for joining us for the half hour. We are back on Monday and Tuesday, depending on where you are in the world. So if you want to send us any feedback on the reports from the week, find us on Facebook. But until next time, we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.